Guys, I'm here with the second part of Victorian poetry video. In this video, we'll talk about the Brownings and Arnold. You won't believe what happened today. I recorded this video for 1 hour. At the end, I cut the video and I realized that I had not switched on the mic. Oh, I thought I would just record the video today and sleep early. Now it is 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm going to record this video now itself because I am determined to do it. Nothing will stop me. So, Victorian poetry, part two. We have already talked about Tennyson, and now we talk about Robert Browning. He was also a very important poet of this age. Browning lived from 1812 to 1889. Browning was the son of a very scholarly father. His father had a library at home, and Browning, who was largely educated at home, read widely at home. At 16, he began to study at the newly established London University. Fatima Rashid from TES. She's roll number one at TES, okay? I miss you, Fatima. I said this in the earlier video also. What happened to Browning when he was 16? He went to London University, Fatima. You know already that there were very old stone universities, Oxford and Cambridge. In the late 19th and also 20th centuries, new universities were established. One of these was London University. He did not study for a long time there. He returned home. And from a very young age, he was writing verse. And he was inspired by our Shelley. Shelley influenced Browning's work and prompted Browning to adopt vegetarianism and atheism. Shelley's writing inspired him to try vegetarianism and atheism. In 1833, he published his first major work, Cham Duivedi. Do you know what is that work? Pauline, a fragment of a confession. Pauline, a fragment of a confession. Now, Browning returned to the dramatic, Browning turned to the dramatic monologue after this. Pauline, etc., we'll talk about in detail later. Let us take a quick look at what he did write in his early years. The next poem was Paracelsus. Paracelsus deals with the life of a Swiss alchemist. And the subject was suggested by the poet's friend, Amédée de Rippert Monclar. Remember, all these biographical details could be important in the exam. Pooja from TES. There are two Poojas, I know. Both Poojas from TES. Remember to note such information. Which of the following prompted Browning to write Paracelsus? Questions like that can come. In 1837, Browning wrote a play, Strafford. That was the first of his many dramatic poems. And he wrote Strafford for the actor William MacCready. In spite of the efforts of MacCready and John Foster, both of them assisted Browning in revising the work for the stage, but Strafford was not a popular success. Now, Tirtha KS, do you know who is John Foster? John Foster was a writer of the Victorian period, and he was the biographer of Charles Dickens. Now, then at this time, he visited Italy. In 1838, he visited Italy. After that, again, he would go to Italy. And finally, he would marry and live there. After a visit to Italy, he published a Sordello. Strafford was a poetic play. Sordello is a poem, long poem. Sordello had a lot of psychological insight into the protagonist. Sordello, in Browning's own words, concentrated on the incidents in the development of a soul. Charumati from TES. Does that remind you of something? Development of incidents in the development of a soul. What does that mean, Charumati? That means later he wrote poems like that and they came to be called dramatic monologues. Dramatic monologues also show the innermost thoughts of a soul. And this Sordello was based on the life of a poet who was Dante's contemporary. How did Browning know Dante? I mean, Dante's contemporary from Dante's Divine Comedy. That means Browning took the topic of Sordello from Dante's Divine Comedy and wrote about the contemporary of Dante whom he talks about, whom Dante talks about in Divine Comedy. Now, Pauline. Manoj, what is the subtitle of Pauline? A Fragment of a Confession. Pauline was published anonymously. It is a retrospective long poem and it shows the influence of Shelley, as I told you before. It was not noticed by critics very much. It was only briefly noticed in a few journals. However, John Stuart Mill liked it. J.S. Mill, the utilitarian philosopher. Don't you know Baikunda Naik? J.S. Mill is a utilitarian philosopher. He wrote Utilitarianism, Subjection of Women. And J.S. Mill famously remarked that he found in Pauline a more intense and morbid self-consciousness than he ever knew in any sane human being. Pauline is almost like a mad poem. Paracelsus is the story of a 16th century alchemist. I told you that before. It is called a monodrama. Ranjit Singh, what is a monodrama? Monodrama is a theatrical or operatic piece. Opera means theater only, but singing. A theatrical or operatic piece played by a single actor or singer, usually portraying one character. Did you understand, Ranjit? Ranjit Singh from YouTube, as well as our Ranjit from TES. Ranjit Babu, his name is. Okay, there are two Ranjits now. Monodrama it is. Paracelsus is a monodrama without action, played by one actor, William McCready, remember? It shows the hero's unquenchable thirst for that breadth of knowledge which is beyond the grasp of one man. Does that theme remind you of something? That theme is the theme of Ulysses, Tennyson's Ulysses. Browning's Paracelsus also has the hero's unquenchable thirst for that breadth of knowledge which is beyond the grasp of one man. Browning's predominant ideas in later poems are there in Paracelsus also. Life without love is a failure. God's will more than human conjecture is behind everything. Remember, Browning is writing in a time of religious doubt. Deepjyoti Medhi, why is it religious doubt? Because this is the time of evolutionary theory, Darwin, the Bible is questioned, right? So Browning's age is one of religious doubt. But Browning is very optimistically and confidently supporting God. He's saying God's will is behind everything more than human conjecture. Sordello, I told you, is a long poem. And did you know it is written in heroic couplets? Sri Lakshmi of TES, heroic couplets. It is Augustine meter, right? It is the imaginary biography of an imaginary Mantuan bard introduced in Dante's Divine Comedy. Sordello is about the relationship between art and life. And he wrote in an obscure style. Obscure means difficult. Sordello was written in an obscure style. Browning's peculiarity is that difficult style that he wrote in. It is not easy to understand Browning's style. It is considered to be an early evidence of modernism. Because in Romantic period and Victorian period, there are slight developments that eventually became modernism. Now, in 1841 to 46 period, Browning's work was published in a series. Listen, Annie and Parvati from TES. 1841-46 period, he wrote a lot of works. All these works and books were all together called under the general title Bells and Pomegranates. Hemlata Bhatt, Bells and Pomegranates is a general title. It's not one book. And it's a biblical phrase also. It refers to the priestly costume. And here in Browning, bells means sound and pomegranates means sense. In his poetry, he is bringing together sound and sense. Now, the poems of Browning that are called Bells and Pomegranates are Pippa Passes. Well, it is not a poem. Do you know, Benisha, what it is? It is a poetic play. Also, books like Dramatic Lyrics, Dramatic Romances and Lyrics and some plays were all part of Bells and Pomegranates. Browning's best known poems date from this period. They are Porphyria's Lover, Johannes Agricola, My Last Duchess. Everybody knows My Last Duchess. Shivalakshmi, haven't you studied My Last Duchess? Soliloquy of the Spanish Cloister, The Pied Piper of Hamelin, How They Brought the Good News from Ghent to Aix, Home Thoughts from Abroad, Shweta Garg from YouTube, please read some of these major poems, okay? You should sit down and read on your own. That is how you'll get JRF. Because unless you have first-hand knowledge, there are no shortcuts, Shweta. The bishop orders his tomb at St. Praxed's Church. The flight of the Duchess also he wrote. Now, Pippa Passes is a verse drama. The first in a series of dramatic pieces. It is about a woman who works as a silk winder. And the concluding lines are very famous. God is in his heaven, all is right with the world. You know what is happening in this play? I told you this is a play. A woman called Pippa, she's actually a girl, 14-year-old or something. She is a silk winder. Her job is to put cocoons into hot water, cocoons of silkworms into hot water and wind it. She has only one day holiday in the entire year. And that day she is walking along the road, which is the stage. And she is meeting many people on the stage. I mean, on the road. And these people are actually corrupt people. This woman is very innocent. She does not understand that these people are corrupt. But in their conversation, from their conversation, we understand that they are corrupt. That is the story. The concluding lines are, God is in his heaven. All is right with the world. Devjani, which book? Pippa Passes. This book was controversial, however, for its frank portrayal of disreputable characters and for sexual frankness. Now, Browning paid a visit to Italy again in 1844. At that time, he read Elizabeth Barrett's poems, okay? Elizabeth Barrett was publishing poems at this time. And Elizabeth was 6 years his elder. She was a semi-invalid in her domineering father's house in 50 Wimpole Street. That is where she lived. Donna. Oh, Donna, I miss you. You're sitting in front and looking at me. I miss you, Donna. Doesn't matter. I'm so fed up with not teaching, actually. I miss my students. That is why I'm calling out everybody's names in the video. Elizabeth Barrett Browning was a semi-invalid. She was very ill and she had a domineering father. They lived in the house called 50 Wimpole Street. And Robert Browning started corresponding with her. Divya and Diya from TES, Divya Pius and Diya Saji, pay attention. He started writing to her. I know you're paying attention because I'm telling you a love story. Robert Browning and Elizabeth Barrett Browning began to write letters to one another and they began to write poetry for one another. And he met her, admired her poems, secretly married her because her father would anyway object. So they eloped to Italy. Where did they go? They went and lived in Florence. Very important town, city in Italy. One day when Corona and everything is gone, we should go to Florence because it's a magnificent city. Sandeep Barai, pass this exam, make money, travel, go to Florence. By then Corona and everything will be gone. Now, the Browning settled there. There, their son, Robert Browning, was born. Son is also called Robert Browning. But son was called Robert Penn Browning. There, they lived until Elizabeth's death in 1861. Now, in 1850, he wrote Christmas Eve and Easter Day. It is not a very famous book. It received little attention. And then men and women came. Men and women, Akshaya and Mithuna. Have you heard of Men and Women? Very famous book. It received at that time grudging reviews, but later it became very famous. Men and Women contained very famous poems like Fra Lippo Lippi. Everybody should know it. It's a very famous poem. Prescribed in universities. A Toccata of Galuppi's. Child Roland to the Dark Tower came. Devagishri from TES, do you know this poem? Child Roland to the Dark Tower came. I know you don't know. I will tell you. This is actually a line from our King Lear. This is a line from King Lear. In King Lear, who is disguising as a beggar, as a mad beggar? Tell me, Steffi Antony. Edgar. Edgar disguises as a mad beggar. And he sings this song. That is the title of Browning's poem also. Bishop Blougram's Apology, Andrea del Sarto, Love Among the Ruins, Saul, Cleon. And then he wrote an eloquent poem for Elizabeth Barrett Browning called One Word More to EBB. Then he also wrote Dramatis Personae. Till now, I told you dramatic lyrics, dramatis personae, men and women. Habib Ali, are you paying attention? Dramatis personae included James Lee's wife, Apt Vogler. Apt Vogler is famous. Chitra Chandran, pay attention. Note down this, Apt Vogler. What is the meaning of apt? But Apt Vogler is a musician. He has invented a musical instrument also. And he's talking about it in that poem. Prospis, Chitra. Rabbi Ben Ezra, very famous poem. Rabbi is a Jewish priest. A death in the desert, Mr. Sludge. The medium, Caliban upon Setibos. Caliban upon Setibos is where Caliban is talking about a god that he believes in called Setibos. Did you understand, Chitra? Now, Browning's characters, let me talk to you about. I will introduce Browning's characters to you. Then you should also read some of these poems. Fra Lippo Lippi is a 15th century Florentine painter. Renaissance Italy is what Robert Browning mostly represented in his poems. Fra Lippo Lippi is a 15th century Florentine painter and monk. And he's being interrogated by some Medici watchmen. And he is actually going out at night for some malpractice. And the Medici watchmen are interrogating him. Do you remember Krishna, RM, Jyoti V from TES, Greetwin, etc.? Have you heard Medici before? In Middleton's Women Beware Women, a Medici prince is seducing the heroine. Then it was to please the Medici prince that Niccolo Machiavelli wrote The Prince. Do you remember? Then Ramya from TES, Swati Yatish. Medici is a dynasty in Italy at that time. You should read what? European History in a Day book. European History in a Day and Western Philosophy in a Day. I hope, TES students, you are reading because you have time now. Please make most of the time. I want you to study everything thoroughly so that by the time exam happens, you will be ready and you will all pass. YouTubers also, please study, put in your best efforts. Okay, this is my dream. Now, Fra Lippo Lippi, I told you, is a 15th century Florentine painter and monk. He's being interrogated by some Medici watchmen who have caught him out at night. These days, if you go out, you will also be caught because it is the lockdown. Now, Andrea del Sarto, he's a Renaissance painter in Florence talking to his nagging wife, Lucrezia. It's a beautiful poem. I think PSC lectureship students should be reading it. It is prescribed for them. Caliban upon Setibos. Shakespeare's Caliban is talking about his world and his god Setibos. Sanjuti Jay, do you know any other work where Caliban is a character? W.H. Auden has written a poem called The Sea and the Mirror. Sanjuti, please look it up, okay? W.H. Auden's The Sea and the Mirror, based on The Tempest. Rabbi Ben Ezra is a Jewish mathematician and scholar. How do you know he is Jewish? Because Rabbi is a Jewish priest. And what is the theme of Rabbi Ben Ezra? Very famous, very important. What is the theme? Rukmanil, do you know? It is old age. Rabbi Ben Ezra begins famously with the lines, grow old along with me, the best is yet to be. Grow old along with me, the best is yet to be. Shrisha, did you know? TES tagline is the best is yet to be. Did you know that? Now, Apt Vogler is incidentally not a Renaissance person. He is from the 18th to 19th century Germany. Apt means abbot. And Apt Vogler is a German music composer. He has discovered a musical instrument and he is... extemporizing upon it. How do I know? Because that is the subtitle. DLP students of TES, are you paying attention as well? The bishop orders his tomb at St. Praxed's Church. That is showing a Renaissance bishop in his deathbed. A Renaissance bishop is in his deathbed. And even in his deathbed, his interest is not in his soul. He's a very corrupt bishop. And his interest is not in his soul. His interest is in material things. He wants a lapis lazuli to be put on his tomb. That is his interest. Can you believe it? He's dying. So that is the poem, The Bishop Orders His Tomb at St. Praxed's Church. Now, my last duchess, it is about the recently widowed Duke of Ferrara. Every one of you knows this poem, I'm sure. The Duke of Ferrara has been very angry with his innocent, naive wife because she is easily pleased. And he gave orders and they died. Can you believe it? Chetan from DLP, read my last duchess if you have not read it already. The grammarian's funeral. There it is interesting because the grammarian is not alive. The grammarian has died. The speaker is a disciple who is carrying the body of the grammarian. And he's talking about the accomplished grammarian who gave too much importance to grammar and did not give importance to life. The next poem is Home Thoughts from Abroad. Jitin Pijos, here a homesick traveler longs for every detail of his beloved home. Then there is Porphyria's Lover. Porphyria's Lover is about a man who has fallen in love with a rich woman, an upper class woman. And she comes to meet him at night and he strangles her to death because he wants to preserve that moment of love. Harishma from DLP, can you believe it? Out of love, he kills his sweetheart. That is Porphyria's Lover. Now, The Ring and the Book. The Ring and the Book is actually not a dramatic monologue. It is a whole book. In The Ring and the Book, there is some story behind it, how he came to write it. Rinu Maman, have you heard about this? He actually went to one bookshop and in that bookshop, he found an old yellow book of documents. This was in Florence. And in that book of documents, he read an actual murder story. A Roman murder story from the 17th century of how an innocent wife, Pompilia, was murdered by her worthless husband. And Chayesh Minglish, he rewrote this story as The Ring and the Book. It is an actual story and it was published in monthly installments, Chayesh. The poem received complimentary reviews and Browning, the king of the mystics at that time, he was called the king of the mystics. He became popular with the reading public. Before that, he was not very popular, remember. Why was he not popular, Jayaraj? Because he wrote in an obscure style. Now, Browning's vitality continued undiminished. He was a very vital writer. There are many poems that he wrote at this time. And his last poem is Asolando, Fancies and Facts. Asolando, Fancies and Facts. This is interestingly, it is on the day it was published that he died. And there are some lines in Asolando that show his character. One who never turned his back but marched breast forward, never doubted clouds would break, never dreamt though right were worsted, wrong would triumph, held we fall to rise, are baffled to fight better, sleep to wake. What does it mean, Renuga? It means we are falling in order to rise. We are baffled in order to fight better. We are sleeping in order to wake. Beautiful. Browning's prolific output during these years nevertheless left him time to write a translation of Aeschylus's Agamemnon. Elizabeth Barrett Browning, his wife, translated Aeschylus's Prometheus Bound in her early career. That was not a very good translation. Browning translated Aeschylus's Agamemnon. And even when he was alive, the Browning Society was founded. Yogesh, this is a very important thing because no poet gets this honor of having a society founded in his name when he's alive. Browning was very popular, that is why. He died while visiting his son in Venice. Browning died visiting his son in Venice. Remini Popuri, remember the son? What is his name? That is Robert Penn Browning. And he wanted to be buried. That was in Venice he died. He wanted to be buried in Florence, but it was not possible. And he was sent back. His body was sent to England and he was buried in Westminster Abbey in Poet's Corner. Did you understand? Now, we'll talk about Browning's style. I told you Browning wrote in an obscure or difficult style, sometimes rugged, sometimes angular. At its best, his poetry shows noble dignity and verbal music. And he used a variety of metrical forms, cleverly manipulated rhythmic effects. And he did not care for describing for the sake of describing, which is what Tennyson did. And see, Rachel, do you remember? Tennyson wrote in a very picturesque style and he focused on the form or the language, not the content very much. Browning was not like that. Browning did not just describe for the sake of beauty. Next, we have to talk about Elizabeth Barrett Browning. Sridhar from Karnataka, did you enjoy? Good. Now, listen. Sridhar, Shekhar, Shankar. Three people are there in TES. Listen, all of you. Elizabeth Barrett Browning was born in 1806 and died in 1861. Elizabeth was the eldest of 12 children of Edward Moulton Barrett and his wife, Mary. She spent most of her childhood and youth at the estate called Hope End near Malvern. Malvern Hills, do you remember? Where did you hear of Malvern Hills, Olivia Mariam Francis? In Pious the Plowman. Elizabeth Barrett Browning was a precocious and ardent student. And Elizabeth Barrett studied with a governess, shared her brother's lessons. One thing, she was an invalid. Secondly, her father was very strict. Thirdly, women did not get education in those days. So she had to study at home. At the age of 15, she suffered a serious illness. And she began to write verse at a very early age, like her husband. Look at this teen, I am Joy. This is Elizabeth Barrett Browning. She produced a translation of Aeschylus's Prometheus Bound. That was in 1833. That was the year in which Robert Browning also wrote Pauline. She later disliked the translation. In 1835, the family moved to London, where Elizabeth enjoyed a moderately successful literary life. Her first collection, Manisha Sharma, was The Seraphim and Other Poems. The Seraphim and Other Poems. It got some favorable reviews. In the same year, she suffered a lung hemorrhage. Ayo. And she was bedridden. She suffered a relapse when two of her brothers also died. And she returned in 1841 to the family home at 50 Wimpole Street as an invalid. Tied to the household of her father, reluctant to grant any of his children independence. Oh, sad story. Now, she embarked on a productive period of writing at this time. Writing poems and essays for the Athenaeum. It was a periodical. The poems that she wrote included, she published a collection in 1844 that is called Poems. It included a drama of exile and Lady Geraldine's courtship. Lady Geraldine's courtship is very famous. Shraddha Pandey and Kavita Pandey, we have two Pandeys here in YouTube. Are you both listening? Good. One of her admirers was Robert Browning, whose verse she had complimented in Lady Geraldine. And a correspondence soon developed. They began writing letters to each other. And it grew rapidly into love. In order to avoid her father's expected prohibition, the poets were secretly married. That was in September 1846. And they left for Italy a week later. They lived there forever until the end of Elizabeth's life. They never came back to England. They lived in Casa Guidi in Florence, where their son Robert was born. In 1850, she published a further volume of poems, among them the Sonnets from the Portuguese. Sonnets from the Portuguese was a group of sonnets that she wrote during her courtship before marriage. And this was followed by Casa Guidi Windows. YouTuber Tribhuvan, do you remember Casa Guidi is where they lived in Florence? On the death of Wordsworth in 1850, the Athenaeum proposed Elizabeth Barrett Browning as an appropriate successor to the post of Poet Laureate. But her greatest work, Aurora Leigh, was yet to be written. Her greatness was not enough. Her great work, Aurora Leigh, came in 1856. But people didn't know that she was so great. So the Poet Laureateship went to whom, Tribhuvan?
went to Tennyson. Now, poems before Aurora Lake came in 1856. After that came poems before Congress. That was in 1860. It supported the cause of Italian unification. Tanuja Krishnan, Italian unification. Have you heard this before? Our Browning also took part in it. He went and fought in Italian unification. Remember, Risorgimento. That you can read about it in European History in a Day. And at this time, poems before Congress was branded as hysterical and unwomanly. Yo. Saddened by the death of her sister Henrietta and the Italian leader Cavour, Elizabeth Barrett, fell ill and died at Casa Guidi. Robert Browning prepared her last poems. Sonnets from the Portuguese. Listen, Rajesh Kumar Yadav is a collection of 44 love sonnets. It was written during the period leading to marriage with Robert Browning in 1846. Rajesh, pay attention. I was saying that Rajesh is from TES. Sonnets from the Portuguese is a collection of 44 love sonnets written during the period leading to marriage with Robert Browning. Elizabeth did not want to publish them because these poems were so personal. But Robert Browning said, it's okay, publish. And these poems did not appear as original poems of Elizabeth. Instead, they appeared as translations of foreign sonnets. She pretended that these are not original poems. These are translations. Sibi, please read on your own and study all this. I want you to pass this time, okay? Now, Elizabeth admired also the Portuguese poet. That is also why it is called Sonnets from the Portuguese. She admired a Portuguese poet, Luis de Camões. And Browning also called her by the pet name, My Little Portuguese. One famous sonnet here. This is famous, Polly. Pauline la Polly. That is from Tess. My dear Polly, listen. How do I love thee? Let me count the ways. That is a famous poem that Elizabeth Barrett Browning wrote. Aurora Lay is the longest and the most innovative work. It is an epic novel. Verse novel in blank verse. Aurora Lay, 1856. Epic novel. But it is an epic with a difference because while usually epics have a male hero, here we have a female hero. Isn't that nice? Here we have a female hero. And Rinuja, this is a woman poet hero whose country's destiny depends on the balance of her deeds. Aurora Lay is also not written in 12 books like an epic. It is written in 9 books because 9 is the Sibyl's number. It is the woman's number. Next is Matthew Arnold. It is a small section because Matthew Arnold will be dealt with in detail in the next chapter, Victorian Fiction and Prose. Matthew Arnold is primarily a prose writer. Now, Arnold was the son of a famous headmaster of rugby school, Thomas Arnold. And for his father, he wrote the, Elegy, Rugby Chapel. Rugby Chapel is an elegy that he wrote for his father. Arnold's legitimate fame is as a prose writer and critic. And Mahima and Samita, pay attention, listen to this. Arnold's poems are not numerous and not of high quality. Classical themes he wrote. He was a classical poet and a moralist poet. He wrote in meditative and melancholy mood. That is a modernist strain. There are early modernist elements in Victorian poetry. I told you this. And he also wrote themes of alienation, stoicism, despair. These are all modernist themes. Not very happy themes. Themes of alienation, stoicism, despair, and spiritual emptiness. Anjali Anand, did you understand? Now, Arnold was the apostle of sanity and culture. Look at Matthew Arnold's painting. And these are his famous sideburns. He wore his beard like this. His poetic career began with The Strayed Reveller and Other Poems. His poetic career began with The Strayed Reveller and Other Poems. And his career, that was in 1849. And it ended with New Poems of 1867. At this time, he had become a professor of poetry. And after he became a professor of poetry, he never wrote a poem. Can you believe that? His major works were Empedocles and Etna and other poems. That was in 1852. And next year, in 1853, he brought out another collection called Poems. That is very famous. It has a preface called Preface to Poems 1853. It's a critical work. Preface to Poems 1853. Harish, Empedocles and Etna was not included in this second edition because he himself criticized his Empedocles and Etna as a depressing poem. Did you understand, Harish? He himself first wrote it and published it, and then he criticized it as a depressing poem. That is, that criticism is there in the preface to Poems 1853. Poems second series, Merope, a Tragedy, that is a play, 1858. Now let us take a quick look at the poems that he wrote, the different genres that he wrote. He wrote lyrics, poetic plays, narrative poems, and elegies. He wrote Margaret poems. They are lyrics. He met some girl in Switzerland, I think. And about her, he wrote Margaret poems. The Forsaken Merman, Dover Beach, Scholar Gypsy, Philomela. These are important poems. And then he wrote poetic plays like Empedocles and Etna and Sohrab and Rustum. Empedocles and Etna and Sohrab and Rustum. Sorry, Merope. Poetic plays I'm talking about. Empedocles and Etna and Merope are poetic plays. Now, narrative poems include Tristram and Isolde and Sohrab and Rustum. Sri Rag, Sohrab and Rustum is based on what, do you know? It is based on the poem Shah Nama by Firdosi. It is based on Firdosi's Shah Nama. Amrita, Shrisha, did you understand? Now, the elegies that Arnold wrote include Scholar Gypsy, Tiresias is for his friend, was written for his friend Arthur Hugh Clow. Manu, he also wrote memorial verses, Obermann Once More, etc. Obermann Once More, etc. are memorial verses that he wrote. Now let us take a detailed look at one of his poems, Dover Beach. It is prescribed in PSC lectureship. So Shalu Surendran, you should be reading it and studying it. The speaker is on the beach, on Dover Beach. What is the peculiarity of Dover Beach, Sayantika? Can you tell me? The peculiarity is that you can see the French coast from this coast. The speaker is on that beach. He's newly married. His wife is there, also there. He's watching the calm sea and the full tide. The moon's bright light shines on the French coast across the English Channel and disappears, while the cliffs of England glimmer. The speaker calls his companion to the window to enjoy the sweet night air. He invites her to listen to the grating of the pebbles. He's inviting his wife. And they are flung back and forth by the waves. He listens to this sound. Sansa, are you also listening? And he says, this sound brings the eternal note of sadness in. The poet remarks that Sophocles had heard this long ago. He is not the only one who is hearing it. Everybody has heard it. Sophocles has heard this long ago. And this is the ebb and flow of human misery. Tom Skurvilla and Sajin Sahib, the ebb and flow of human misery is compared to the sound of the sea. They are hearing it now. Why is he so depressed? Because of Victorian dilemma. And Dover Beach continues. He says, the sea of faith was once full. Now it is not full. Why, Sharat? Because of evolutionary theory, Victorian dilemma. Once upon a time, the sea of faith lay round the earth like a girdle, protecting it. Girdle is like a waistband. The sea of faith was once full and it lay around us in a beautiful, like a beautiful ornament or protecting us. Yet now the speaker hears only the melancholy roar of the sea of faith. He is describing the sea of faith as now roaring. Did you get that, Lifni Shami? The poet tells his beloved that he should be honest with each other. They should be honest with each other because they don't have anything left now. The world which looked once upon a time looked beautiful and new, now does not have joy or love or spiritual light. It has nothing. It has no certainty, no peace. All that they have is each other. And these are the last lines of Dover Beach. Did you know that Arias, the different Arias from YouTube and TES? And we are here as on a darkling plain, swept with confused alarms of struggle and flight, where ignorant armies clash by night. Famous last lines of Dover Beach. Crystal Jasmine, please pay attention to this and remember. Thyrs is next. It's a pastoral elegy. It commemorates the death of Arnold's friend and poet, Arthur Hugh Clough. Arthur Hugh Clough. Now, Shanta Christina, Arthur Hugh Clough was also a poet. Did you know that? And Clough died suddenly. Clough is presented as Thyrsis and Arnold as Corydon. Thyrsis and Corydon are characters from Virgil, from Virgil's eclogues. And Thyrsis lost in a singing match in Virgil's eclogues. And he's comparing that loss to Clough's death now. Did you understand? The famous lines are there in Thyrsis, where Arnold recalls the Oxford countryside, which the two of them explored as students in the 1840s. Arthur Hugh Clough and Arnold had explored the Oxford countryside as students. He's remembering that. Now, Ram Singh, have you read Scholar Gypsy? The Scholar Gypsy is also a pastoral elegy, but it is an unconventional pastoral elegy because it is not about the death of one man. Like our elegy written in a country churchyard, it is about the death of an age, of a death of values. The Scholar Gypsy is based on a 17th century story that Arnold found in Joseph Glanville's book, The Vanity of Dogmatizing. Joseph Glanville wrote The Vanity of Dogmatizing, where there is a 17th century story of an Oxford scholar who leaves Oxford disillusioned and he joins a band of gypsies. And this Scholar Gypsy is considered to be the companion poem of Thyrsis. Both are what? Pastoral elegies. Did you understand, Papi Hari? The Scholar Gypsy is the story of an impoverished Oxford scholar. And he was dejected by the fret and fever of modernity. He left his studies to join a band of gypsies. And these gypsies are better than the city people because they have traditional knowledge and original imagination. And Arnold says that rumors are that the Scholar Gypsy is not subject to aging and death. He was again seen from time to time around Oxford. The ending of Scholar Gypsy is with a famous epic simile. There is an epic simile or Homeric simile at the end of Scholar Gypsy. Have you heard of that, Gopika Murali? The epic simile of a Tyrian merchant, seaman, fleeing from Greek competitors. Greeks are coming and Greeks are going to take over. And the Tyrian merchant is running away from the Greeks. Empedocles and Etna is a dramatic poem published anonymously in 1852. I told you in the collection Empedocles and Etna and other poems. In poems 1853, he excluded this long poem and explained in the preface that the mood of elegiac gloom and helpless suffering, which finds no vent in action in the poem, is too depressing. The poem is too depressing, he said. Arthur Hugh Clough, friend of our Matthew Arnold also, we should know. Amrita Raj, pay attention. Arthur Hugh Clough also wrote poems charged with deep-seated despair and despondency, like Arnold himself. It is the typical example of the Victorian intellectual seeking in vain moral and physical certainties. You can't find any certainties, Yogesh. Everything, Yogesh, in this world is uncertain because of Victorian dilemma. Did you understand? And the Victorian intellectual, sage writers, they were called, Yogesh. Writers of great learning, intellectuals. They sought in vain to find certainties, but they didn't get. That is what you find. The same theme. That theme is what you find in Arthur Hugh Clough also. Bothy of Tauber na Vaulik. I don't even know how to pronounce it. That is a very famous poem by Arthur Hugh Clough. It is called A Long Vacation Pastoral. The American contemporaries of the Victorians were Ralph Waldo Emerson, Nathaniel Hawthorne, Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, H.W. Longfellow, Edgar Allan Poe, Henry David Thoreau, Whitman, Melville. If I ask you rapid fire about all these people, will you be able to answer? Please look up these writers. That reminds me, let us have rapid fire in YouTube. Tomorrow, I will post a video in YouTube. You can come and attend to my rapid fire at that time. Okay, it will be based on all the things that I have taught you so far. And also other things. Rapid fire will really help you to remember and understand and pass the exam. Okay, next will be the Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood. I'm not talking about that now because it's pretty long. I will make it another video. Okay, guys, thank you very much.